2021. I'd like to let you know that we've received apologies from committee member Paul McClellan. I'd like to ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take items four in private. Item four will be an opportunity for members to reflect on the evidence they have heard earlier in the meeting on short-term lets, and item five will be a chance for the committee to agree its approach on the scrutiny of the budget for 2022-23. Do members agree to take items four and five in private? And that's members all agree. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's work on short-term lets. This is the second of three sessions on these regulations. The committee will hear from the Cabinet Secretary next week. And I'd like to invite, I'd like to welcome to the committee Tony Kane, who's the policy manager of ALACHO, Andrew Mitchell from the Regulatory Services of the City of Edinburgh, Ilsa Rayburn, who is the chair of Community Land Scotland, Chief Inspector Nicola Robson from Police Scotland, and Leon Thompson, who's the executive director of UK Hospitality Scotland. Thanks for joining us today. We'll move straight to questions, and witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please add an R to the chat box to indicate this. And I'm going to start with the first question. I'm going to direct this to Ilsa Rayburn and Andrew Mitchell from Edinburgh Council. So my question is, do you think that the proposed short-term lets licensing system will effectively tackle negative impacts some short-term lets on neighbours and communities? And additionally, do you think over-provision powers are required for local authorities? And maybe Ilsa, if you start.
Hi there, Ariane. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Great, excellent. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak today. I don't want to say I'm nervous, but I'm slightly overwhelmed about being the only sort of community representative here, because as you know, my colleague Kirsty Henderson from Place had to give her apologies. She's a key worker and couldn't get additional time off work to attend this. So I think, first of all, I'd just like to put on record, I think it's a shame that there aren't more community voices being heard in these meetings, but I'll do my best to represent those communities that I've spoken to about this. So first of all, that the first question was around, will the short-term lets licensing help deal with the negative effects? I think the licensing scheme as a whole is to be hugely welcomed. It's taken such a long time to get to this point. I know it's been under consideration for a number of years now, whilst short-term lets have continued to operate. So I think there are lots of elements of the licensing scheme which will impact positively, not least the issues around health and safety of individual properties and ensuring that they meet at least the requirements of private tenanted lets, long-term lets. I think that's absolutely critical. I think having a license so people can find out who owns a short-term let, even though that's via the local authority, is really useful if complaints are to be made, because the current system is not working. We know that the only potential routes, if you have a complaint at the moment, is either via the police, by some sort of antisocial behaviour, and of course by the time things are investigated, the people that have caused the nuisance are away, and the owner of the short-term let can disclaim all knowledge of it, or via the planning system. And we know the planning system is hugely overburdened already. So I think that, yeah, it's a really positive step and to be welcomed. But there are elements of the sent out in October by the Cabinet Secretary, which hugely watered down the potential effectiveness. One of those is around the need to have natural names of the owners available. And we think that's for a number of reasons. It's never been really clear as to why you wouldn't have owners' names freely available when you have that for houses in multiple occupation and the landlord register. So we're not quite sure what the difference differences between short-term lets and those types of operation when they're both commercial, you know, they're both commercial operations. And given the Scottish Government's particular move toward transparency around ownership through the Register of Controlled Interest in Land and the Land Register generally, it seems wrong here that those provisions around making sure that natural names are included and publicly available have been taken out. So I think that that's a real concern of ours. Coming then to the issue of overprovision, overprovision is absolutely essential, the overprovision element of it. The planning control area orders won't address the issues around overprovision, particularly in places like Edinburgh and in some of the rural communities like Skye and Mull and Tiree and the east coast of Fife, etc. We believe Place and Community Land Scotland believe that the removal of the overprovision powers shows a fundamental misunderstanding of the scope of the new short-term let control areas and planning legislation. So we do welcome those, but they only remove the materiality check on whether the change of use of a dwelling house is material and would require planning permission. For short-term let control areas to be used to tackle the overprovision of short-term lets by denying a property planning permission, there needs to be a supporting policy in a council's local development plan. And an LDP, local development plan, can only be changed every 5 years. The City of Edinburgh has put into motion the process to put this policy into their LDP. So on that basis, the short-term let control areas which control overprovision in any sense, and we need to see the overprovision policy reintroduced into the legislation and the licensing scheme to give local communities and local authorities the ability to control the numbers of short-term lets in very specific areas where they're either causing a problem in cities like Edinburgh, where you have huge numbers that have hollowed out the community, or in places like Mull and Skye and Tiree, where huge numbers of short-term lets have impacted massively on the availability of affordable housing stock, particularly for young working families. And therefore, people are being made homeless and not able to return or move to those areas and address the issues of depopulation as a result of the huge numbers of houses being taken out of permanent residential use and put into short-term let. Because if you can get your property, you can rent it for £500 a month to a local family who's providing important services and sending their kids to the school, or you can let it for £1,000 a week for a short-term let, it's really a no-brainer. The market is completely uncontrolled, and we need the overprovision policies back in the legislation to enable local communities and local authorities to be able to manage that. So thank you. I've gone on a bit there, but I think those are two really important points. Thanks, Ariane.
Thank you, Elsa. And could we now hear from Andrew? That would be great. Same question.
Good morning, committee. I think the council strongly welcomes the introduction of the short-term let licensing scheme. And I think, as your previous speaker said, it seems to have a long time coming in terms of the concerns of local communities in Edinburgh. The sector currently is largely unregulated, and the licensing scheme will give local authorities important powers, mostly discretionary powers, to tackle some of the issues that communities face. In terms of the overprovision, I think the council hasn't, I suppose, formally reached a view as to the overprovision elements being taken out of the legislation. I think it would be fair to say that I'd imagine quite a number of elected members on the council, and indeed the community at large, would have preferred that those measures stayed in the legislation. But that being said, as your previous speaker highlighted, I think Edinburgh's quite far down the road in terms of looking at its LDP and consulting on the short-term let control order within planning context. So in terms of the legislation running in parallel and providing that protection, then we're already taking those steps to put that issue before the council so that they can make a decision on that early in the new year.
Thank you very much for that response, Andrew. I've got another question, and I'd like to direct this question to Tony Kane and Leon Thompson. So Tony and Leon, I would be interested to hear what your views are on the changes made to the draft licensing order from the version presented to our predecessor committee in February.
These forgive me, Convener, these are the changes that were set out in the Cabinet Secretary's letter earlier on this, a couple of months or so ago. On balance, one or two of them make sense, and there are others that that would be more concerned about. So the changes around notification, for example, I think make sense. The changes that require the applicant to do a neighbour notification rather than the council also make sense. I think the question around the overprovision elements, though, is really about what we think they're going to achieve. And our concern, and it's kind of in part an answer to the last question, is that there are some areas, not many, but very definitely some areas in Scotland where there are far too many short-term lets and the number needs to be reduced. And there is nothing in either the licensing regime or the planning provision that will allow for the active management down of the number of short-term lets in an area. And we've heard from one member of the community, I've spoken to others, they all say the same thing in those most pressured areas, which is that this substantial overprovision is doing great damage to local communities, to individuals who live in next door to poorly regulated or poorly managed short-term lets, but also to the local housing market and the way they constrain the availability of accommodation, particularly affordable accommodation. So my concern about the changes is principally that actually it's not clear to me how any of these provisions will allow a reduction in the number of short-term lets in those most pressured areas. But also I think the indication of an intention to set out an average fee, but also to provide stricter guidance around the use of inspections are frankly inappropriate. Local authorities know how to manage licensing schemes. They know what the sensitivities are in their communities. They know how much it costs to deliver licensing schemes, and both the fee and the regulatory regime in terms of verification, but also enforcement is a matter for the local councils and should simply be left to them. The issues vary area by area, ward by ward, so dramatically that I do not think it's possible for the government to make properly flexible guidance at that level, and it really is a matter for councils to manage manage those issues.
Just before I bring in Leon, I've got a supplementary for you, Tony, on your comments about overprovision. So what do you think we could do about, what would we need to bring in to kind of manage down the in the areas of Scotland that
I think you simply have to go through a process of removing licenses and permissions to operate. And one of the objections to that is always going to be, you can't do that. People are doing this. It's their business. You've got to stop them. And I was thinking about this earlier. We regularly prohibit activities that were previously unregulated. And this is one of those areas. 10 years ago, there was no such thing as a short-term let. It has taken 10 years to get to a place where we understand how it needs to be managed and the risks of unmanaged short-term lets. We simply now need to be fairly bold and say there are too many in these areas and we are going to select. Now, that needs to be fair. It needs to be transparent. But you simply need to select those that can no longer operate. I would suggest Edinburgh's approach around tenements, for example, is a good starting point. Short-term lets in flats, particularly in very high-density areas, are extremely difficult to manage in a way which is properly sensitive to the local community. I would also argue, by the way, for strict liability on the part of the operator and the owner. The idea that somebody can disappear out of the country and then nobody's liable for their bad behaviour is offensive. The owner has to carry strict liability for things that go on in the properties that they manage, and that should be written into these regulations.
Thank you very much for that. And Leon, can I come back to you on the question about your views on the changes made to the draft license order from the version that was presented to the previous committee in February?
Thank you, committee, and thank you, convener, for the question. I think the changes that have been made in the order as it's come back actually show that the government has listened to the concerns of my colleagues and who represent the short-term letting sector, and I think that some of these changes are certainly to be welcomed and do reflect the fact that short-term lets are an important part of the mix for tourism in Scotland, and I think the changes certainly take away some of the more restrictive elements that were in place in the original order, which is helpful for tourism to continue to thrive. UK Hospitality Scotland, we support the licensing order that's been brought forward. Priority for us is to arrive at a point where all accommodation businesses are operating in the same way, following the same rules, and liable for tax as well. Those are the overriding concerns for UK Hospitality Scotland and for our members. But I think it is pleasing to see that things like over-provision powers have been removed, because you could see that that would create a lot of challenges for people running short-term let businesses. Similarly, focused use of inspections as well, and then working with local authorities on guidance to reduce the fees, which has been another major, and as you know from last week's evidence session, is a major concern for businesses. So for UK Hospitality Scotland, the changes which have come through are welcome. We're not anti-competition. We welcome the fact that we have a thriving short-term let market in Scotland, and competition is always good, and we're not here to stifle that competition, but clearly we are in support of a strong system of regulation, so that short-term let businesses fall into line with traditional accommodation providers.
Thank you, Leon. And I see in the chat that I think someone else wants to come in, and we think it's Ailsa. Ailsa, did you want to come in briefly on this?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just very quickly, in terms of how over-provision could work, under the new Planning Act, there is, of course, the opportunity for communities to introduce local place plans together with local authorities. And that's where we see, if there was a call and a need for an over-provision policy on a very local basis, then that would be a great route to do it through, a very effective route, because you could consult with everybody in the community and then come to a local decision as to what would be an appropriate number of short-term lets for that particular community. And it will differ from community by community, and it is something that actually the Cairngorms National Park Authority are currently doing as part of their draft development plan. So there are processes in place for doing this in a democratic and open and fair and accountable way. That's the point I wanted to make. Thank you.
Thank you very much for adding that very useful perspective and a great point and a tool for communities. I'm now going to move on to questions from committee member Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And before I ask my questions, I'll just refer members to my register of interest. I am still a serving councillor at East Ayrshire Council. I've got two questions this morning, and the first one I'd like to direct to Chief Inspector Nicola Robison, and also to perhaps Andrew from Edinburgh. So the committee has heard that powers already exist to deal with illegal or antisocial behaviour associated with a small number of short-term lets. And I'm thinking particularly of the evidence that's contained in the letter from Police Scotland. So I'm concerned about the possibility of women being trafficked across the country into prostitution. I'm worried about County Lines drugs activities, and also the potential for puppy farming. Do you think that the powers that are already in existence have proven effective in practice? And if we could start with Nicola, please, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks very much for the opportunity for allowing Police Scotland to feedback in relation to this. So in response to your question there, Eleanor, yes, absolutely, there are powers that exist at the moment in respect of legislation that we can use. However, what we do find is that creates certain limitations and obviously presents us with further challenges in respect of how we can then support local communities when they're coming to us with potential issues. And that is primarily caused by the quick turnover of obviously different persons from week on, week in, every weekend, which we find it very difficult then to really get that intervention and prevention opportunity that we would like. The proposed licensing system would obviously give us the opportunity to feedback into local authorities to give our point of view in respect of whether that person is a fit and proper person. And it would just allow us then to be able to do our checks and ensure that we are safeguarding any persons who are going to be utilising these properties. And also by doing that, we then obviously can identify the owners of these, knowing that they're fit and proper persons, which again helps us support the local communities and obviously the local authorities if problems are identified to us.
Thank you very much. And Andrew from the City of Edinburgh, can we hear from you as well, please?
Thank you. I suppose the core benefit of the licensing system is, I think, as Nicola just said, it brings transparency. We know who the operators are. They are subject to checks that they are fit and proper. It allows local authorities and the police to tackle particular problems that arise, and certainly Edinburgh's experience thus far is that the current powers are nowhere near effective in doing that. The antisocial behaviour legislation that currently exists is designed to deal with people in the community, people who are living in tenancies who are creating problems over a longer term, and I think it would be naive to think that it would be easily used to deal with types of problems that communities in Edinburgh are facing. I think we had given evidence to the government, and I'm happy to send it on to your clerks if it helps, of how difficult it is to use the very limited powers under antisocial behaviour legislation to tackle problems short term. Let's, I think in one case we ended up spending £30,000 worth of court costs trying to get a management control order to deal with just one landlord. So the current antisocial behaviour powers do not assist in any meaningful way the current problems being faced by communities.
Thank you very much for that, Andrew, and I think that the committee would appreciate if you did send that evidence that you gave to the government onto to us. Thanks very much. I have another and final question from myself. The committee has heard concerns that local authorities may not have the staffing or the resourcing to effectively administer a licensing scheme or take prompt enforcement action. Do you share these concerns, and if so, how could they be best overcome? And I would like to direct that to Tony from Alacho and then also to Andrew from Edinburgh. So, Tony, over to you first, please.
Yeah, yes. I mean, resources are an issue across local authorities and have been for a number of years, and this is an additional burden and it will be a challenge. However, this is also a Civic Government Act licensing scheme, which means that the fees can be set in a way which covers, should cover, in fact must cover, the whole of the cost of the activity. That being the licensing process itself and verification, that doesn't include enforcement action, and that's where the difficulty arises. So, I mean, the first point is the council will know what it's going to cost to set up an appropriate licensing and verification process, one that fits with the concerns and the pressures and the issues arising in local communities, and I think that is a matter for councils. The bigger issue arises in the enforcement activity, the day-to-day of responding to and addressing concerns and complaints when they arise, and that's where the principal difficulty will be with this scheme as it is with HMO licensing, for example, and to an extent landlord registration too. So I could make a special plea, if you like, for specific funding to assist councils in enforcement around these issues. I'm not sure that's the appropriate solution, or one that that colleagues in COSLA would be in favour of, but there will be a challenge in finding the resources to carry out enforcement work outside the licensing process, because there always is, and that's an issue for the government and COSLA to talk about, I think.
Thanks very much, Tony. And Andrew, do you have anything to contribute on that issue as well?
I think local government is well used to operating a licensing system under the 1982 Act, and yes, it will be a challenge, particularly if you have the scale of Edinburgh, the number of properties that we are likely to have to deal with, but local authorities will put in place provisions to fund dealing with the applications as they come in. I think in Edinburgh's case, the current year budget has a funding allocation of £250,000 to start looking at the startup costs of dealing with licence applications and the stuff that we talked about earlier. I think the fee structure within the Act is what will allow local authorities to cost recover the cost of operating a licensing system. And I think, reflecting back on some of the evidence you heard last week, I think I would say that local authorities, in particular Edinburgh, are bearing these costs now. We are dealing with communities who are unhappy with the rapid and uncontrolled expansion of short-term lets, the problems that come with that. I think colleagues in planning are highlighting they had over 400 inquiries in a 3 or 4 year period. So we are, local communities are paying for the trying to manage some of those effects currently, and a licence system which allows local authorities to recover an appropriate fee from the businesses which they're regulating would be appropriate way to redress some of that spend that's currently going on.
Thank you very much for that, Andrew, and I think your last comment is particularly helpful. Thank you. Convener, back to yourself.
Thank you, Elena. And I'm now going to invite a question from Megan Gallagher.
Good morning, panel. And like Elena, I would like to draw members to my registered guests, as I am a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. I also have two questions this morning. And if I could start with the first question. We heard from witnesses last week, and they raised concerns over the cost of the short-term let license. How much would the panel expect a three-year short-term let license to cost? And do they believe that this could effectively harm small businesses and their ability to function? And if I could start with Leon, please, and then Tony. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for the question. I mean, the cost of the licence has been an ongoing issue for short-term let operators and the bodies that represent them. I mean, the Scottish Government's been pretty clear and consistent all the way through the process that they see a licence costing between £200 and £350 for a three-year licence. So that seems to be borne out in terms of the conversations that they have had with several local authorities around this issue. I think key in the conversation as well is actually sort of, you know, making sure that there is guidance in place to actually keep those costs as low as possible. But I mean, clearly at the moment what we have is a huge discrepancy between the figures which the Scottish Government has been very clear about and the figures which are being used by the AWSC and so on. As I say, the Government has been very clear on the figures that it has, and we have talked about the options around potentially capping the fees as well, and I understand that whilst that's not necessarily an option, I do believe that having some guidance around setting fees will be helpful in terms of how the licensing structure or the licensing process would work. I mean, there are clearly very cost-effective ways of actually managing that system, and some of that allows for self-certification up to a point as well, which is helpful and should allow local authorities to conserve resources and time and thereby not pass on additional costs to businesses. So I think there's, you know, it's obviously still clearly an area of concern for some businesses, but if we are looking at between £200 and £300 for a three-year licence, that really is a relatively small amount of money, I would suggest.
Thank you, Leon. And Tony, please.
Yeah, I don't have a set of exact figures in my head, but I would expect the range of fees to be very similar to the range of fees we see for HMO licensing. It's a similar activity with a similar range of concerns, and that range of fees reflects the local decisions that are made about how licensing schemes are managed. I think that the primary constraint is the fee will be set to cover the costs. I don't think the operators can have any legitimate ground to claim that other people should pay for the regulation of their industry, but it's a common cost. Everybody pays the same fee within a particular area in terms of impact on business. These are the terms of trade, and it is for government and local government to set the terms of trade. And if there's a cost for licensing, then all the businesses in that area operating within that licensing regime will pay the same cost. I think it's a red herring, frankly. The issue here is whether or not the regime that's being proposed will be effective in delivering the level of control and safety for communities that we're talking about. And local authorities, as has already been said, have a lot of experience in running licensing schemes. They are subject to best value regimes which control the way in which they go about their business. Nobody has presented any evidence from other licensing schemes to suggest that councils actively, willingly or deliberately set excessive fees for whatever reason. The fees will be set at the necessary rate to deliver the licensing regime that is considered appropriate for that area. And those are the terms of trade, and those people that want to enter this trade will need to accept those terms.
Thank you, Tony. And I think Andrew's indicated. After Andrew, if I could move on to the question, please.
Thank you. I think I just wanted to, I suppose, reiterate the point. I suppose local government is well experienced at setting fees to recover, and there is transparent mechanisms for doing that. I think Edinburgh contributed fully to the government's calculations, and I think, like Tony, we would argue that the HMO fees for those who are operating, in effect, commercial operations 24/7 is much likely to be the cost that local government will set the licence at. And within the Act, there's no reason why if somebody's only operating occasionally or perhaps renting out one bedroom whilst they're still living in the property, they might be subject to a less onerous licensing system beyond the mandatory conditions, and the fee would no doubt reflect that. And I think I would strongly urge the committee to trust local government to, you know, represent the communities and reflect on the cost, because it's something that they do day in, day out.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you for everyone's contributions there. I'll move on to the next question quickly, convener, and then I'll pass. Thank you. I was wondering if the panel had any concerns about the inclusion of traditional bed and breakfast accommodations within the definition of a short-term let, and if the panel can provide any reassurances to those who own a traditional B&B accommodation. And if I could perhaps start with Andrew this time round, and then if anyone else would like to come in.
Thank you. So the inclusion of bed and breakfast in the traditional sense makes absolute sense. If you don't include that, all you will do is create a loophole which will allow every short-term let to offer, you know, a take-away breakfast and then claim they're exempt from the licensing law. So we strongly support that loophole being closed by including traditional bed and breakfast within that category. Again, as I've said previously, licensing systems which each local authority will deploy will reflect where they see the risks are. So, for example, if somebody is living on the property, which is perhaps more of a case on a traditional B&B, they might be subject to a less onerous inspection regime, less requirements. If I take Edinburgh as an example, the number one category of short-term lets we get complaints about is those where there is no host or no landlord on the property. The property, the tenants or the guests are just left to their own devices, nobody managing the properties. And you can see that you could distinguish between them and traditional bed and breakfast when you're designing what the local rules will look like and what the level of checks would be at a local level.
Thank you, Andrew. I think Leon and sorry, Tony, then Leon, or Leon, then Tony, I think it is. Sorry, I can't see the chat function there.
That's great. I'll jump in here. Really, just a short couple of points. I mean, it is regrettable that B&Bs, which traditional businesses, have been sort of captured by this, but I completely understand why that is the case and the need to close the loophole. But I mean, it is encouraging to hear what Andrew just said in terms of working to make sure that B&Bs are not subject to less onerous requirements, and I think that will actually help those businesses quite a lot. Thanks.
Thanks, Leon. And Tony, please.
Yeah, I think from Andrew's evidence, you hear the voice of experience in managing licensing schemes and the types of responses that might be appropriate for lower risk premises. I think on B&Bs themselves, the risk of avoidance is real, and if the idea that somebody might offer a breakfast as a way of getting around things seems a bit far-fetched, that's exactly what private landlords did during the 80s and the early 90s in order to avoid, or during the 80s rather, in order to avoid the regulations in place at that time. It was very common, it was very damaging, and it was very exploitative. So that is a real risk. That's not a made-up thought. And the other issue is around the fit and proper person test. I agree. We had a traditional B&B operating three doors up for us for 10 years. The guys, long term in business, never any issues apart from the occasional family on the doorstep with suitcases. And I have no doubt that many of these operators see this as an imposition. But there is a risk in the relationship between residents and landlords. The landlord is resident. There is a vulnerability there. And for me, it was a gap that there was no fit and proper person test for B&B operators. And it's a good thing that we will now have that degree of protection for those that might be at risk.
Thanks, Tony. And I think Ilse is looking to come in. Sorry, convener.
Thank you, Megan. Just quickly, I think one of the concerns that communities have in particular is that the industry likes to present this particular industry as all sort of individuals making a little bit of extra income on the side. They're all small businesses. Well, of course, we know both from the Scottish Government data and some Sunday Times data that more than 55% of listings just on Airbnb, and we assume that's replicated across other booking agencies, are held by multi-listers. So this is actually big business, it's not small business, and I don't think that data and that evidence has come across in what you've heard so far. So almost 40% of listings across of owners across Scotland have more than three properties, and 8% have more than 100 properties that are run as short-term lets. And in Edinburgh, over 10% of all the owners have 10 or more properties. So I would really urge you to think about the nature of these businesses, and a lot of them are not small businesses. They're really big commercial operators. And, you know, there is some concern that that's perhaps why this whole issue of transparency is very important to those types of operators, and that they don't want people to know how many of these types of properties they have. So I think we need to be thinking again about what the nature of a lot of these businesses are. They're not small, local, independent granny letting a room in a house. That time has been and gone, and now it's really substantial big business in a lot of places. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Ailsa, for coming in with that that perspective. It's, I think, really important to hear. We're going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a few questions. Firstly, to look towards some of the unintended consequences. So I wanted to ask the panel specifically if you're aware of any evidence from other industries which are subject to local authority licensing at present, whether or not licensing renewal produces significant disruption for their businesses, specifically what proportion of license renewals are regularly refused by local authorities for other industries. So I wonder if the panel had any data on that. I'll maybe start with Andrew and then come to Tony.
Thank you. I think, again, that was one of the points I suppose struck me from the evidence of last week of, I think there is a fear in the industry of what a licensing system will be. I think the legislation using the 1982 Act is a good model. It's well understood. The reality of licensing decisions on the ground is that the vast majority of licences are granted. The legislation is quite clear. A licensing authority shall grant a licence unless there is a good reason not to. One of the principal advantages of a licensing system is it is in the business's interest to deal with any problems so that they don't come into problems when the licence comes up for renewal. So certainly in the case of Edinburgh, refusals of licence are in the hundreds compared to we would process over 20,000 applications a year. It's not a large figure at all. And actually, if you're a business who is likely to have your licence refused, then the problem will be how that business is operated, not that the licensing system is not operating well.
Thanks for that. Can I bring in Tony and then Leon?
Yeah, I'm very happy to reiterate Andrew's evidence there. The councils are not looking unnecessarily for work and to start poking about in licences for businesses that have been operating perfectly effectively over the previous licence period. When I worked for Stirling Council, I signed all the licence approvals, hundreds of them in a week, and almost everyone was approved in a routine way. The issues arise when there are complaints. The operators will know when there are complaints and when there is a problem, and will be well geared up in advance to address that in the renewal process if they're in a position to do that. I don't think the renewal process needs to become a burden. But again, to repeat what I said earlier on, these are the terms of trade, and all the operators in the area will need to go through exactly the same process, will face exactly the same challenges, and will be under exactly the same requirements in terms of the way they operate and the way they engage with the council. I don't see anybody being disadvantaged here. I do see communities being protected.
Thanks for the question. Thanks for bringing me in. Really to say that across hospitality businesses are also subject to licensing at the moment, particularly alcohol licensing. Speaking from that side of things, you know, businesses manage perfectly well with the licensing regime, manage with applications, they manage with renewals. You know, the system that's being proposed for short-term lets will obviously guarantee, you know, right of reply and to make appeal and so on, where there are potentially challenges coming. So that is, you know, just the nature of sort of regulating this market. But I can understand why some businesses will be concerned about this. It is new territory for them. And the key thing here is to make sure that businesses just understand the process fully so that they're equipped with all the information that they need.
That's helpful. Thank you. As the panel members will know, previous witnesses have told the committee that licensing of short-term lets could lead to a significant reduction in their availability and potentially cost the Scottish tourism industry tens of millions of pounds in lost revenue annually, even given the disruption we've seen during the pandemic. So how would you respond to those claims and the impact this will have on the industry? And I'll maybe bring Liam back in there, and if anyone else wants to, then could they put an R in the chat?
Thank you. I think the claims, you know, they're obviously sort of borne out from surveys which the groups have run amongst their members. I mean, I think sometimes that doesn't necessarily sort of present the full picture. It obviously depends very much on how questions were asked. I think at the moment as well, you know, businesses within tourism are obviously in a difficult situation. So perhaps businesses are not feeling particularly upbeat at the moment. So that may be a factor in why people are viewing this in a negative way. I think there's a lot of points of view floating about as well and being put forward, which is perhaps sort of getting in the way of the facts. And I think that, you know, businesses really need to sort of understand fully what is being proposed here, and that this is not sort of something which is unusual or outlandish. This is simply about bringing businesses which are currently unregulated into the regulated marketplace, in which they will operate in a very similar way to their competitors, which is, you know, absolutely key and important. And we're not looking at prohibitive costs as far as, you know, the government, Scottish government calculations go. So I think, you know, when hopefully we get past this point and things are perhaps a little clearer for businesses, they will actually be able to make sensible decisions about their future operating arrangement.
That's helpful. Leon. Thanks, Leon. Can I bring in Elsa and Tony?
Thank you, convener. Thank you, Miles. I think 2 points. A lot of the evidence you've heard will obviously be in surveys undertaken by the industry. There's been an independent report done by the Economic Policy Institute, which finds that claimed increases in economic activity by short-term letting platforms are often vastly overstated, because that spending would have occurred anyway by travellers staying in other types of accommodation. So there is little evidence that cities with an increasing supply of short-term Airbnb rental accommodations are seeing a large increase in visitors, and that's, of course, borne out by the Visit Scotland economic impact of tourism surveys, which showed no significant 2011 and 2018, and yet short-term lets had increased by at least tenfold during that period. So we would really query that link between increasing numbers of short-term lets and increased tourism economy. We think it's substitutional and not incremental. And two further surveys have indicated that only 2-4% of those using this type of accommodation would not have taken the trip anyway. So I think that's a really clear statement that this is a substitute for other types of accommodation. I stay on the West Coast. These hotels and traditional B&Bs around here, they completely bemoan the impact of this type of much cheaper, unregulated, untaxed accommodation and the impact that's having on the tourist industry. So that's the first point. And the second point I would make is that obviously licensing has been introduced in a number of other cities and locations worldwide where this type of activity has been shown to have a really serious detrimental impact on local communities in places like New York and Paris and Amsterdam and Vienna. and rural locations, and it's not significantly impacted on the numbers available. Just as Tony and Andrew have already said, it's a cost of doing businesses. And if you think this is, you know, if £300 a year for a licence enables you to change your property from achieving £500 a month on a traditional short-term let to £1,000 a week, you know, that's pretty good return for money. So I'd really query some of these economic assumptions and statements that are being made. Thank you.
And Tony, did you want to come back in there?
Yeah, very quickly, two points. One is simply to support everything that Elsa's just said there. I think there's she makes the point very strongly. There is absolutely no evidence to suggest that short-term lets have in themselves boosted the tourism industry, or that if they reduce in number, they will reduce the tourism industry. They have substituted quite aggressively, I think. And I think the other point is that can we get away from the idea that tourism is of itself some kind of sacred cow in the world of business? It is possible to have over-tourism. It is absolutely the case that we have over-tourism in some areas, and changing the terms of business around that and changing the way you manage these things and reducing tourism and the way it impacts on communities is probably going to be a good thing. I think what's absolutely clear, though, is that we have a number of very large and very powerful operators who have been existing in what has essentially been an unregulated, I'm tempted to call it a Wild West context around these things for a long time. We have seen them being very aggressive in their opposition and undermining of democratic attempts to regulate them, and quite happy to engage in and encourage hosts to engage in unlawful activity as well, ignoring court orders as we have seen in a number of places. So there is something really important about these businesses understand that their terms of engagement have to be exactly the same, and their respect for the processes and the democratic controls around them have to be the same as everybody else. Tourism is not a sacred cow. It is not the only industry in Edinburgh or the Western Isles or Islands that provide jobs. And actually, there isn't any evidence that short-term lets, which didn't exist 10 years ago, have changed the world of tourism. And given the way things are going at the moment, I think it's impossible to predict where tourism will be in 5 years' time, and that's got nothing to do with short-term let, with licensing of short-term lets.
Thank you for that. And just finally, my final question was with regards to data around the link between short-term lets and the housing market. I just wondered if anyone on the panel had any evidence with regards to that, and the potential outcome which the Cabinet Secretary said this legislation would have, to help address the housing crisis, because we know there's 5 times as many empty homes, for example, in Scotland, than self-catering units. So I just wondered if the outcomes of this legislation, if the panel had any evidence of where that will be achieved, or maybe bring Tony back in, and then if anyone else wants to, please put an R in the chat, and then I'll hand back to you, convener. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the questions where, I mean, in general terms, our data around the operation of the housing system and the housing market isn't good across the piece. So that we are short of data in some areas is no great surprise. The other thing to bear in mind is that, and evidence provided in response more generally to these consultations has demonstrated, that the short-term lets are problematic in a housing market term in a very small number of locations. So it makes it extremely difficult to generalise. But I don't think anybody, and certainly none of the communities involved, are going to look at Skye or Central Edinburgh or the East Nuke and say that the massive growth in short-term letting in these areas and the transfer of properties out of traditional residential uses into a commercial tourism use hasn't had an impact on the availability of accommodation, but the price of accommodation in these areas as well. And you've only got to look at the map of, and it's principally Airbnbs that get mapped because of the way they release the data, the map of Airbnb through Edinburgh, you can see that the availability of accommodation and the price of that accommodation has been impacted by the growth of short-term lets. So we are short of data on how precise that is. We are talking about a relatively small number of communities, but those communities are facing some fierce problems as a consequence.
Thank you, Tony. And I think Andrew and then Elsa would like to come in.
Thank you, Kinrina. So I think when you listen to the industry, they present an image of it as just single people renting out a bedroom from their property. I think Edinburgh a few years ago commissioned Retties to do some research, and I think their research highlighted back, I think, at 2018, was something like 5,000 properties potentially lost to the housing market in Edinburgh, and that was back then. The impact of that is that private rented sector rents go up because there is more competition for the properties that are remaining. And again, communities tell us this. You don't need research. Communities tell you this, is that communities in some areas are being hollowed out because short-term lets has become the most dominant, and certainly parts of central Edinburgh. And certainly that, if it helps, committee, I can send you that research that we did, albeit a few years ago, that highlights the displacement of, you know, homes from the housing market into commercial short-term let operations.
Thank you, Andrew. Yes, that would be very good to see that research. And yeah, Ailsa.
Thank you, Kavina. Just really to echo Andrew and Tony's points there on the impact of local prices, both rental and capital values, and the availability in many rural communities, sort of particular tourism hotspots in the West Coast and on the islands, where sort of 30% of properties have been put over to this type of use. That's hugely impacting on the ability of local working age people and families to secure local housing, which obviously then impacts on services. And Andrew used the phrase there, hollowing out of communities. And that's absolutely the case in many places on Mull and Skye and Tyree and Applecross and Plockton. You know, we can all name these places where that's happening. I think the other point to make is, as well as the impact on prices and availability, is a lot of these operators don't pay either council tax or they claim small business rates relief. Even if they own 100 properties, they're able to claim small business rates relief on each of the properties, and therefore they're not making any financial contribution to the local services, and we're obviously seeing then a loss in council tax and a loss in revenue for local communities and local authorities because these operations are not paying any of those taxes. So it has a really broad impact, well beyond just the loss of that particular house to that community. And I think if you speak, and that's why it's such a shame that more of my community colleagues weren't here to tell you much more articulately and clearly what the impact is on these places. Thank you.
Thank you, Ailsa. And Leon would like to come in.
From a hotel and wider hospitality perspective, I mean, certainly information that I get from members operating both in rural locations but also in urban locations as well, is that they increasingly find it harder to secure their workers that they need, because there just aren't the people there. People can't afford the accommodation. The accommodation isn't in place. So this does have a knock-on effect for other parts of tourism as well. On the point about taxation, it is very important that all tourism businesses and accommodation businesses are paying an appropriate level of tax into their communities. And I think that's helpful. The licensing scheme will hopefully lead to that eventually, and that will be helpful for actually sort of boosting support for tourism in areas where perhaps there is a lot of negativity right now.
Thank you for that, Leon. And we're now going to move to questions from committee colleague Willie Coffey.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wonder if we could ask the panel just to give a brief response to this question. Last week we heard that the panelists last week seemed to prefer a registration scheme rather than a licensing scheme. Could you offer us a view of which you might prefer, which your organisation might prefer, and tell us why, please? And I wonder if I might start with Andrew.
Thank you. So I would describe a registration scheme as licensing light. I think it would be nowhere near as effective as a proper licensing system. There are two categories of registration systems. So ones that are in disrepute, so the old controls over estate agents back in the 70s and 80s, where, again, to use a phrase that Tony used, the Wild West, where anybody could be a estate agent, no qualification, and, you know, ripping off home buyers left, right and centre. There is the landlord registration scheme that currently exists, and whilst in the face of it that might look attractive, but actually if you look behind that, landlord registration is probably private landlords are probably one of the most highly regulated industries in Scotland, and actually the landlord registration can afford to be light touch in that regard, because there are significant other legal protections and controls on how they operate their business, not least the first tier tribunal. So I think if you had a landlord registration scheme for short term lets, it would achieve no more than having a register of where landlord short term lets are, but wouldn't allow local authorities any meaningful powers to tackle some of the problems we've spoke about here today.
Thanks, Andrew. Could I bring in Leon or Tony or Ailsa, please?
Yeah, happy to come in now on that. Thank you. Yes, this is obviously part of the debate that's being had. Within tourism, we all agree that there needs to be regulation, but this is where we disagree. The challenges around a registration scheme is that it will largely be toothless, may well lead to more complexity, and ultimately, we believe, just won't deliver on the things that we're looking for, which is actually about ensuring that all short-term let businesses are visible, that they're complying with health and safety measures, which are not particularly onerous, and they're actually, you know, applicable to even the smallest hotel operators in Scotland at the moment. And also that ultimately these businesses are paying their share of tax as well, which is really important, particularly at the moment. So we don't believe that a registration scheme would deliver that. We feel that really a licensing scheme, which is thorough and thought through, will actually deliver what we're looking for. And I mean, on the point of the conversation last week from the witnesses, there was a lot of talk about a registration scheme, but the plans don't appear to be sort of fully fleshed out, and even the proposal from the ASSC suggests having a twin approach. So some businesses could be registered, those professional operators, and then there would be licensing for those unprofessional operators. I mean, I'm not entirely sure how that scheme would work, but the difficulty with any of that now is that obviously this, even going back and looking at those proposals again, would just cause delays in a system that we need to have in place as quickly as possible.
Thank you, Leon.
Thanks, Leon. And if I can bring in Ailsa and then Tony and then Chief Inspector Nicola Robertson, if you want to come in on this too, that would be great to hear from you as well.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks, Willie. Yeah, I think echoing on Leon's points there, the registration system that's proposed doesn't address any of the issues around transparency, around health and safety, around taxation, or around overprovision. So the proposals that have been put forward by the ASSC aren't developed in any sense. And if there is some thought about investigating those further, obviously that would lead to further delays in the implementation of any system. There's no clarity, and they haven't been clear about who would manage that scheme. I think initially they were thinking about Visit Scotland, but as far as I'm aware, and others on the call may know more, Visit Scotland have not expressed any interest in managing that scheme. Of course, it would be self-regulatory if it's done by the organisations themselves, and therefore no element of independence or transparency. And as Leon has said there, they are still proposing that you need a licensing scheme to sweep up the bad operators. So the local, the licensing scheme that's being proposed by Scottish Government is still an integral part of what they're proposing, but with no opportunity for local authorities to recover any costs around that. So they're proposing a hybrid model that won't work in any sense and won't provide that transparency or independence. And I think there's lessons that Scotland should be learning here from other places that have issues with short-term lets, who have all rejected registration schemes and gone for licensing schemes. So I don't think there's probably any need to reinvent the wheel. We should be looking at what other places are doing that have been through this process. And they have decided that an independent, transparent licensing scheme is the way forward. And that's fairer for everybody, both the operators of short-term lets and, as Leon's already mentioned, the rest of the tourism industry, as well as local communities. Thank you.
Thanks, Ailsa.
Tony, and then Nicola?
Yeah, my apologies. I think two observations on the issue of registration against licensing. We license taxi drivers, we license window cleaners, we license these activities because they present a potential risk in the relationship between the operator and the client and the customer, and managing that risk is important. But the other thing that occurs is there is a reason why the chief inspector is in this room. And that's because there is a very clear connection between serious and organised crime and short-term lets, as well as private letting, private renting more generally. And serious and organised criminals are both serious and organised, and we need to have a system which is capable of addressing the risk that they present. And that's not an exaggeration, and I'm absolutely confident Police Scotland would not have committed a chief inspector to this conversation if they didn't think there was a serious issue. There is a serious issue, and it is interesting that the industry itself has largely denied that and is seeking to avoid transparency in regulation. I think we need to listen to what the police are saying, hear the warning bells that come from a sector which has those connections, which doesn't want to be regulated, and not be fooled by them. This is important in safety and important in tackling organised crime in Scotland as well. And I think the idea that a registration scheme is a suitable alternative is nonsense.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you, Tony.
Inspector Robinson.
Yes, thank you. Obviously, just echoing Tony's concerns there in respect of, from a Police Scotland point of view, we would absolutely be supportive of the proposed licensing system in respect of those concerns that surround criminality in the sector, which we've based on intelligence that we have received. In addition to that, obviously, it would give us further tools in respect of the antisocial behaviour elements that are reported to ourselves. Obviously, at the moment, we don't have a system that recognises short-term lets because they aren't licensed. So any antisocial behaviour that's reported as a result of short-term lets, we obviously can't quantify that actual issue at the moment. So it would allow us to do that. And obviously, the most important part is that with a licensing system, we then obviously have that opportunity to identify whether those persons are fit and proper to be obviously holding that licence. And again, that is for the safeguarding element of the persons utilising that. That would also allow us the opportunity to check our intelligence system and check, obviously, and make an assessment ourselves as to whether that person is fit and proper. So we are fully supportive of the proposed licensing system for those reasons.
Thank you for that.
Sorry, Willie, did you have more questions?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to clarify if, on a point of law, should an unscrupulous operator be using a short-term let and has a licence withdrawn, does that make it an offence, a criminal offence, continue to operate? And similarly, if it was a registration scheme and an unscrupulous operator continued to operate, is it an offence to do so under a registration scheme? Chief Inspector, or even Andrew, might be able to help clarify that.
We would obviously be treating that the same as we would in respect of taxi drivers, etc. as well. So we would look into the full circumstances, and with the proposed licensing system, that would allow us the tool to do that.
Mm-hmm. Andrew, any view on that? Is it an offence to continue to operate without a licence, or is it an offence to continue to operate if you're removed from a register?
I think in practice the answer is usually yes to both questions. Certainly in terms of licensing, it's a very definite yes. I think the disadvantage of most registration schemes is that there is a presumption that you can continue to operate until such times as there is a problem, whereas in a licensing system, as the Chief Inspector said, there is proactive checks before you're allowed into the system, and that would be one of the key differences between licensing and registration normally.
Thank you, Andrew. And I see Elsa would like to come in on this as well.
Just very quickly, as I understand it, the proposal that's been put forward by the industry is for a self-regulating registration scheme, so it wouldn't have any powers attaching to it. So if you fail to meet the registration renewal requirements or the initial registration requirements, there's actually no penalty whatsoever. You can continue to operate. So I think for me, as I understand it, that's the real difference, is that licensing will stop bad actors, but will enable the vast majority of good actors to proceed. But a self-regulatory registration scheme won't have any powers at all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ailsa. In the interest of time, convener, I'll hand back to you. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. And I'm going to ask a quick supplementary to Ailsa and also to Andrew. So the survey responses submitted to the committee raised concerns that the proposed legislation was designed to tackle issues experienced principally in central Edinburgh. But considering this, I'd like to hear your views on how short-term lets and housing demands interact in the rural, and how you think short-term lets and housing demands would interact in the rural and island context. So Ailsa, if you wanted to come back on that, that would be great.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I'm aware that the industry has sort of been focusing particularly on central Edinburgh, where I think the evidence is almost overwhelming of the impact, particularly around antisocial behaviour. And in rural communities, it tends to be much less around antisocial behaviour and much more around the impact that we've already discussed on the local values, both rental values and capital values, and pricing local people out of the market, pricing young people out of the market, pricing working age people out of the market. In places, as I've already stated, you're removing 30% plus of traditional long-term residential housing stock from its availability, and that's moving over into short-term lets. So that then reduces the number of houses available, and of course you can never rebuild. I know that's been something that's been suggested, we should be building more houses. Well, yes, we should be building more houses, but we are never going to build 30% more houses in Skye in the next 5 years to replace the amount of stock that's being lost. When you speak to local young people, particularly in places like Skye and Mull, their stories are really depressing and really sad, because they've got good jobs, they've got family connections, they either want to stay or they want to return to their home. And of course, the Scottish Government is really promoting repopulation. And yet actually the critical factor of available affordable housing is hugely impacted by the loss of so much stock to this type of activity, which, as we've already said, of course, is commercially provides a much, much better return than either living in it yourself or renting it out to the local plumber and his family. So I think the evidence is there to see. I'd really urge all the committee members to, if they haven't already, read the recent report that Place and Community Lands Scotland put together, which gives some really compelling evidence on the impacts of this type of activity in the north and the west and the islands, on the Ayrshire coast, in places like the Cairngorms and the East Nuke. As we said, it's not across all of Scotland, but it's across enough areas of Scotland to require a nationwide scheme. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Ailsa. Andrew, I called on you, but maybe you don't have so much of a rural perspective, but if you want to come in on that, and then also Tony, I see you want to come in too.
I think briefly, convener, I think what Edinburgh had always argued for a discretionary scheme, albeit there are mandatory elements, and I would make the point that you have to take the licensing scheme plus the planning controls in its totality, and that maybe for more rural communities it is the planning controls that might be the more effective way of looking at this, and local government up and down the country will balance between those and two schemes to try and find a solution that meets their local needs. And I think that's what Edinburgh advocated, giving local authorities that discretion and freedom to tackle local problems.
Thank you very much for that. And Tony?
Just partly to echo that, licensing schemes under the Civic Government Act operate across all 32 local authorities. They're all very different. Those authorities understand their areas and they operate those schemes in a way which is right for those communities, and they are accountable to their communities as well. We have an election coming up in May in which they will be held accountable. So I think, as Andrew I think said earlier, there's an issue here about the Scottish Government trusting local government, but also acknowledging local government sway within its own sphere of government, within its own range of democratic accountability. These schemes can operate flexibly. This isn't a one-size-fits-all, because the Civic Government Act doesn't operate as a one-size-fits-all. And councils in Moray Council or Angus Council or Dumfries and Galloway or Garden View won't be saying, well, Edinburgh are doing it this way, so we'd better. They'll be saying, how do we make this work in our communities, for our industry and for our economy? And I think that one of the critical issues here is, can we just trust local government? We know what we're doing. They know what they're doing to get on and manage these schemes effectively.
Thank you very much for that. And I'd like to now bring in Mark Griffin, who has some questions.
Thank you, Kamira. My question is kind of follow on from the discussions that we've just had. And the first question was around data, and then the second question was follow on from the data, how we adapt any system locally. But perhaps I can come first to Andrew, since he talked about study work that taken place in Edinburgh, I think, in 2018. My question was really around, do we know how many short-term LEPs there are in the country? Do we know the scale of the issue that we are regulating for? And if we don't, if we're doing this in the absence of any data, can we sure that we're going to get it right? So I'll just put that first to Andrew, just ask if there's been any refresh of that 2018 study so that we perhaps know the scale of what we're trying to accomplish.
I think I wouldn't agree with the industry that we don't have any idea of the scale. I think one of the problems we face is the lack of transparency in the industry. So local authorities such as Edinburgh have made some attempts to quantify the market. I know that Scottish Government have commissioned consultants at various points to quantify the market, and indeed the industry at various points have given statistics to both certainly Edinburgh and indeed the Scottish Government, which quantifies the market in terms of thousands. I mean, the conservative estimate, I think, going into the pandemic was there was about 12,000 short-term lets operating in Edinburgh. I suspect that number may have dropped somewhat just because of travel restrictions. However, I see no reason why the market wouldn't return to that level once the travel and tourism returns to pre-pandemic levels. And I think the core one of the core benefits of the licensing system is it will allow us to know accurately who's operating, where they're operating, and design a system to deal with that. So certainly in Edinburgh's case, our working assumption is that north of 10,000 will be applying for a licence, and we will put in place processes to manage that. And I think the idea that thousands of properties will just voluntarily leave the market, I'm not sure that there's much evidence from other licensing schemes being introduced which would bear out the idea that existing industry or existing businesses would just retreat from what is a market that's operating.
Thanks, Andrew.
I think Ailsa would like to come in.
Just quickly, thank you. There is some data, of course, and the Scottish Government referred to just those listings on Airbnb in the whole of Scotland, which was 31,884 in 2019, and they were active listings. And we know that's just one. So we know there's booking.com. The issue, of course, is that there's no transparency because there's no licensing system. So nobody actually knows the exact number because we don't have any way of collecting that data. The other way of checking is for those properties that have applied for small business rates relief as letters of holiday business, and councils do, of course, have that data. And that's coming back to Andrew and Tony's point about local authorities probably being much more clearer on the ground as to the numbers, particularly in hotspot areas where they're causing a problem. So I think you do have an issue with transparency and numbers because we don't have a licensing system, and it enables lots of people to operate under the radar. But then, as I say, locally, there's probably quite a lot of information which local authorities can use to help design the licensing system at a local scale. Thank you.
Thanks, Ailsa. That brings me on to my second point, and just to really ask the panel whether they feel that a national system is something that needs to be introduced, or whether there are particular local authority areas who would rather not expend the resources to do this for what they would perhaps locally see as not a pressing issue. So just to, maybe to kick off with Nicola, to ask if Police Scotland have any data on issues around antisocial behaviour in the first instance, whether that is common across the country or is much more localised. And if anyone else wanted to come in on issues of a national versus devolving powers to local government to run locally, I would welcome any indication.
Thanks, Mark. Obviously, in respect of antisocial behaviour and what's attributable to short-term lets, as alluded in the written submission, unfortunately, we don't have a way of recording that at the moment. Obviously, we can, of course, record antisocial behaviour as a whole, but we can't attribute what proportion of that is attributable to short-term lets specifically due to it being unlicensed at the moment. And that's obviously one of the challenges we've got and a benefit of a licensing system, in addition to the obvious fit and proper person perspective, then of course it would allow us to be able to check then our national licensing system and see how many short-term lets we've got registered, etc., and then take it from there as to any problems that were identified in local policing divisions. But at the moment we don't have those figures, unfortunately.
Thank you for that, Nicola, and it looks like Andrew, Tony, and then Leon would like to come in.
Thank you. I suppose I would struggle to, identify a benefit of a national system. I think the consequence of that would be to remove flexibility to deal with local circumstances, and you would in effect be imposing a one-size-fits-all on the whole of Scotland. So I suspect nobody would end up being particularly happy. I think Edinburgh would be unhappy that the scheme wasn't strong enough for their local needs, whereas Highland or Moray would be unhappy that the scheme was too onerous given the circumstances that they find themselves in. So I would struggle to identify any real benefit from a national system other than, I suppose, command and control in terms of, you know, centrally dictating what the system does. Licensing schemes operate in many categories of business, which we've discussed this morning, and I'd see no reason why local government shouldn't be trusted to get on with implementing a local scheme that meets their local needs.
Thank you, Andrew. And can we bring in Tony?
Yeah, I confess I think I slightly misinterpreted this question when I first heard it, so I'm going to answer it in two ways. The first one, if the suggestion is a national scheme will be run from Edinburgh, then I think the principles of subsidiarity would suggest that that's absolutely not the way to do this, that local authorities ought to be, and locally controlled organisations ought to be the ones that are delivering this scheme. So I can't understand why you would make a suggestion like that when we already have 32 organisations that are well experienced and perfectly capable of operating a Civic Government Act licensing scheme within their local area in an appropriate way. But if the alternative is my initial interpretation is, why don't we just have a scheme that covers the hotspots or covers the areas where there are problems, the safeguarding issues are national, so we need a scheme that is capable of being in place across Scotland, so that the safeguarding issues in particular are there for every community where short-term lets are operating.
Thank you, Tony. And Leon?
Thank you. Mark, I've interpreted this question as referring to just having licensing schemes in places where there are hotspots, and I think that really we need to have this operating at a national level, and I think that's actually more helpful for businesses as well, because then they know exactly what they need to do if they're if short-term let owners are working across a number of different local authority areas. Then the legislation is the same, and they're not having to sort of mix and match depending on sort of where they're actually operating. So I think, you know, this needs to be implemented across the board. I think ultimately that is more helpful for businesses and for communities as well.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Ulysses.
Thank you very much, Mark, and thank you to the panel. We have a little bit of time left, and you've been all very, very good and succinctly answering the questions. So I just wanted to open it up and see if there's anything else that any of you feel is really important that we need to hear or you want to underscore. And if you want to put an R in the chat, that would be great. And I'm particularly keen, Nicola, because you haven't really had a lot of opportunities here. If you have anything else to add that you feel like's not been aired, that would be great. So I'm just looking for ours in the chat if anyone wants to come in on anything that may not have been covered. And I'll let that be for a moment. Okay, so Andrew and then Ilse. So let's start with Andrew and then Ilse. And then if others want to come in with anything else that you think of, please do put an R in the chat. Ilse.
Thank you, convener.
Sorry.
Thank you, convener.
Sorry for that confusion.
Oh, sorry, you go first.
Yeah.
Thank you. It was just one of the points raised by the panel last week that the operation of the licensing scheme could, in effect, allow a de facto ban. And I think it was just to give the committee reassurance that the protections within the 1982 Act, which is fairly comprehensive in how applications will be dealt with and licences granted, simply wouldn't allow that to happen. And if an operator is seeking to renew a licence, provided they apply before the licence expires, then the licence would continue in effect until a decision is made. So actually, in terms of that aspect of disruption, potential disruption to business, which they were foreseeing, just simply wouldn't happen.
Thank you very much for that. And Ilse.
Thank you, convener. Just a quick point, that the vast majority of operators we are sure are good actors. And of course, we do want sustainable tourism. All of our members in Community Land Scotland want sustainable tourism. But coming back to Tony's point earlier, there can be such a thing as over-tourism, where the benefits of tourism are hugely outweighed by the disbenefits of tourism. And that is, of course, felt by local people. So they must have more of a say in how that's managed. So that's the first point. And I think the second point is that we know from New York and Vienna and Amsterdam that some of these big global corporations, which is what they are, will take every opportunity to challenge licensing, to challenge new schemes, to challenge new systems. And there's lots of court cases, including where they've been fined. So I think we need to be cognizant of that and recognize that, you know, a self-administered registration scheme, given that context and that background of how some of these intermediary agencies operate, would be completely pointless, and that we do need the backing of the local authority and Scottish Government to better manage this for all the good actors out there and the good operators, as well as to manage the bad operators. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And Tony and then Leon.
Yeah, just to, it was mentioned briefly, but just to go back to the suggestion from the Cabinet Secretary that natural names would be taken off the licensing scheme. I have no idea why that suggestion has emerged. I'm not aware of any other schemes in which the named operators aren't identified in the scheme. And I have a small concern. I was a member of the working group on this that met throughout 2021. The issue was never raised in that working group. It was never discussed. The operators didn't raise it. And it emerges in the Cabinet Secretary's letter after the operators walked out of those conversations. There's just a little bit of a concern in there about transparency in the process, and but also the effectiveness of extremely well-resourced and very well-targeted lobbying, which I suspect what's brought that about. But I don't understand why natural names wouldn't appear on the register, and it seems to me to be a layer of removing transparency that it's and a dangerous precedent, because it's not something that that we see in other schemes.
Thank you, Tony. And Leon.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, really just to kind of follow on from the point that Ilse was making, and, you know, it's absolutely true that, you know, the vast majority of operators in the short-term let rental market are professional in what they do, and many are complying with everything that they need to at the moment. So the licensing scheme will not actually put undue burdens and new pressures onto them, but what it will do is actually sort of make sure that everybody understands that the STL sector is professional, it is licensed, and that people are paying the taxes that they're due to pay as well. And I think that is so important as we look to have tourism recovery. We want to have communities behind tourism and welcoming visitors back, and I think that this licensing scheme can be an important part of that.
Thank you very much. And I just want to check, Nicola, would you like to come in with some final words? It would be most welcome.
Yes, absolutely, if I could. Thanks, Convener. As I mentioned before, obviously, yes, there is existing legislation that is open to ourselves to use at the moment in respect of antisocial behaviour particularly. However, it does have limitations and obviously that presents us challenges. And of course, we want to support the local communities and local authorities as much as we can to prevent antisocial behaviour issues and obviously the potential for criminality in the sector of short-term lets. And of course, ultimately, to ensure the safeguarding of the people that are using these properties. By the licensing system, that would obviously allow us to check if these people are fit and proper persons to be the owner of such premises. And obviously, it will achieve consistency and bring it more in line with other areas that are licensed and obviously the details of which are kept in our national licensing system. It is obviously acknowledged that there will be a resourcing impact on local authorities and ourselves on the introduction of this system, but I think the benefits outweigh the disadvantages of that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And so that's been a very informative session. So thank you very much for joining us on the panel. I take your point, Ailsa, about needing to get more community voices in this space, but I trust that we have managed to air out all the views here. And with that, I want to say thank you very much for joining us. And you can now leave, and we're going to continue on to our next agenda item.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to contribute.